want to get up here. We gotta finish out the night. We're gonna be here all night. We got a time factor. We're not in eternity yet.
All right, Doc, I'm good.
Okay, thank you very much. If you have any questions, again, come out on a Thursday.
Third Sunday.
Every third Sunday.
Of the month.
Of the month at 1100 East 55th. The session is free. We go through much, really stuff in detail here and give you instruments of what you should be doing.
Let's give him two hands. That's what I'm talking about. Dr. Lee, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
As we continue to show in the convention as we go, there's Paula. Can you have your son bring the table up? Don't nobody go nowhere. We're going to be readjusting. We got four dynamic cameras. Dynamic cameras. Our new people to the team is Sadat Mohammed with his lovely wife, Nubian. We have Audrey Wright, who I haven't seen in almost. Audrey can tell you how long he's been with us. So it's a blessing to see her. She's doing phenomenal, phenomenal things. And we have, again, if you want to hear Friday, Sister Sakura Jackson. Unbelievable. Okay? That's just the start. So don't go anywhere. This is off the chain. We're going to set it up because we'll have them sitting in a panel discussion so you can get your questions answered. Now, without further ado, I want to introduce one of Pam's own, Felicia. Felicia Danzer brings with her a lot of skills. Now, I knew Felicia had a lot of other experience, but she's also affectionately known as the Mother Diva. Now, Felicia is a volunteer and media marketing expert. She does a lot of good things. Good spirit, good nature, go-getter, does a lot of things. Felicia is ambassador for house music, okay? She gets it in. She can dance, she can roll side, you know, something, you know. So without further ado, Felicia is going to come and talk about some things that you need to know about some of our vendors who are not privileged to be here. Okay, and when she wants you to know, just get your CM, ask about it so that we can give you have complimentary copies of books available. Felicia, tell us a little bit more.
Good evening, everyone. This has been just such a beautiful blessing. We actually just had something miraculous happen. But first, I'd like to acknowledge someone that's here, Derek with Tower Mix Records, who is a house music producer. I was so shocked to even see him here. And for those of you who don't know, electronic dance music is bringing in 30, 40 million a year in some places. But in order for you to be successful, you have to have multiple streams of income. So you got to be the DJ, the producer, the engineer, the owner of publishing, and all of that. But something miraculous just recently happened. Audrey had decided not to speak because she was in such severe pain. And I said, well, let me get you something for the pain. She said, well, I have something. I said, stop. Don't you take no drugs. So I went to Ursula and I got a cup of her tea. And then I had Frank work on her, the pain that she was having in her shoulder. And he actually showed me on her ear where the pain is. Because if you all can see these charts, our body is a tabernacle, so everything in the body is connected, and everything starts in the head cavity, and also with your hand. The scripture said he brought the children of Israel out with a mighty hand. So he put these little things in her ear, and now she's ready to speak. Her pain has miraculously, praise Yahshua. But it's because of the knowledge. The scripture says our people are destroyed from lack of knowledge. So if you don't know, how can you grow? And this is what we teach here at PLM. We teach you how to be self-sustaining and to learn the fruits of the Spirit so you can have a sustainable life. Now, one of the gentlemen that's going to be coming here tomorrow, and I just recently found out through Ms. Porter that usually when you do conferences like this, the people that come in from out of town, usually the organization will pay for their trip and their housing. But this gentleman really wanted to be with us, so he paid his own way here to Chicago, and he'll be coming in tomorrow. He wrote a book called Cancer's Best Medicine, A Self-Help and Wellness Guide by Maurice Tanika. And for those of you who may or may not know, it's been predicted that in the next 5 to 10 years that everybody's gonna have cancer. So it's very important that you get this information, because Dr. Warren teaches us about various herbs that can heal the body, that rid the body of toxins. I know my mother had to go to the doctor, and she was deficient in every area to the point that they gave her 28 vitamins, and I called Lee. Lee said, wait a minute. He said, the hospital push drugs, they don't push vitamins. Your mother was deficient in every area. You know, and we just don't know about the importance. I know Dr. Thomas will be coming up talking about the importance of vitamin D. There's so much information. Also, Dr. Warren had mentioned APMEX. APMEX.com is where you can go and buy silver. You can actually buy a silver dime, which is 90% silver, for $3.32 if you just buy one coin at a time. And the shipping is $10. They also sell gold by the grams. Most people can't afford an ounce of gold, which is about $13,400, but you can afford $50 for 1 gram. So this is some wonderful information. This is life-sustaining, it's life-saving. And I'm very excited to be a part of this movement. I've been out in the community preaching about this information. And last year I went to New York and I signed a contract with one of the largest silver coin dealers, First Commemorative Mint, to start our celebrity silver, gold and silver movement, because unfortunately we live in a world that is driven by advertisement and celebrity. So as Dr. Warren explained, a 1 ounce silver coin is about $25, but if we put Beyonce on it, we can sell it for $100, because that's the world that we live in. So, you know, my concept was, since we live in a celebrity-driven society, then let's put the celebrities on the silver and gold. Therefore, people will start buying them, and as soon as you start buying silver and gold, now you become an investor. So these are things that you're not going to really learn out in the world. It takes a lot of research. It takes a lot of dedication. We had a brother here yesterday who healed his wife from an ovarian cyst, but just by detoxing. And these things are very important for us to know. And some people just reject knowledge. I'm very grateful that Audrey decided to have an open mind, because some people are so addicted to pharmaceutical drugs that they don't want to hear nothing about no herbs. Herbs is witch doctor. Herbs is, no, we can't. We don't want that. Because you've been embedded in this society and driven by these advertisements. And if you watch television, the drugs that they have coming out, a year later, you see a commercial. If you die from taking this drug, or you got this side effect, call this number for a class action lawsuit. You know, it's not worth it. When Yahweh Elohim, or Lord God, has put the herbs in the earth to cure you, he has put the silver, the gold, the platinum. I know Darren wants to sell some platinum records. House music go platinum, jacket up. You know, these are things that our Creator has given us to sustain our life. And really, you know, it should be a line around the corner. You know, this room should be filled, and it is. It's, you know, it's filled with invisible principles. But once again, is our panel ready? I want to thank you all for your time, and thank you for coming out. Because many are called, but few are chosen. And if you guys don't know anything about Dr. Lee Warren is the most requested guest on the DemCat YouTube show, the Gold Channel YouTube show. He was getting 100 hits per hour. And on the Mark Sims VP Chicago show, his appearance on that show got over 117,000 hits on YouTube. And he is known all around the world. He's now started treating some celebrities. Some of you may know VH1 star Ahmad Gibbons, who's known as Real from The Stallionaire from the VH1 TV series. He was diagnosed with stage 4 colon cancer and rectal cancer. And so we treated him over the phone and over the email and shrunk his cancer tumor. But once again, you have to continue with taking, you have to maintain this. You can't take AZIT and go eat some chitlins. That's not going to work. So, you know, you have to change. And I know some of y'all are like, well, you big as a house. Yeah.
It's going to be off the hook. Because in this economy, y'all ain't got fed in 2 days. Y'all had a full course meal of health, of wealth, of solutions, of a better tomorrow. Am I right or wrong?
Yeah.
Give yourself a hand for being here and getting this knowledge. Now, what I do is I'm an information scientist. And what I do is marketing. So some people want to actually got clients in here. And it's a good thing. My dad told me one day you're going to go in the room and people are going to know you, man. I'm like, damn, there ain't nobody going to know me, man. I'm in your shadow. 20 years later, I walk in the room. See, I'll be right. A good friend of mine, years ago, serious person. I gotta jump the gun, Audrey, on you. Audrey's the only person I know. Now, it's a couple other people now. She had people in there, like, learning how to stitch in snow. Am I saying that right, Audrey? Just a little bit. She's going to give her own bio, but I'm saying I was amazed in the quote-unquote neighborhood where she was creating jobs, doing it. I'm saying these are real-life people. I just point out because I haven't seen everybody else I know. I see her all the time. So I just want to throw that commercial out. But, I'm just excited. What I do is I'm a marketing guy. So, you know, if you got a business, or you want a business, or you're thinking about business, then everybody needs a coach. You know? I'm not Muhammad Ali. I'm Dundee. Anybody know who that is? So you don't hear about Dundee, do you? Raise your hand if you never heard about Dundee. Okay. He's a coach. You know, I'm that guy. You know, I get you in the ring now. I show you how to fight, take some licks. But hit back, because this economy says you better hit back and do what you got to do, all right? So while we're doing it, we're waiting on the camera to get
come
set
on,
up.
I'm ready. I'm ready.
Camera will be rolling. What I'm going to do is I'm not going to do the introductions. I'm going to start, and I'm going to ask. We need 5 minutes?
5 minutes.
Okay. So tomorrow is Sunday, you all. This has been this has been Media Group. Here with the PLIM organization, and acronym stands for Power Latent Man. We are in conjunction with Loyola University here right now, 2014. We have a guest of panelists who are doing great and wonderful things in the community. They're going to express themselves to you, but before we get started, we're going to start with them telling you a little bit about themselves and going forward. We're going to start with Sakura Jackson.
Good evening. Okay. I know it's been a long day. So I'm going to ask for a little bit more energy because I know our panelists is coming with some wonderful information for you. So can we get a good evening?
Yay.
Good evening.
There it is. All right. Everybody's still here. My name is Sakura Jackson. I am the CEO and founder of Brain Power Consulting. And for those of you who didn't hear me earlier in today, I am a business doctor. And for those of you who don't know what that is I help you get well. Now, what does well look like for you? I believe in the impossible of people. And that means I believe you're possible and you're possible and you're possible and you're possible. I heard it said several years ago by Robert Kiyosaki that if you're working a 9-to-5 and you realize that you do not have enough money to do what you need to do, then get a second job. So most people think he means go out and find a job. No. If you got another 8 hours that you're willing to give to someone else, give them to yourself. Go out and figure out how possible your future is. I'm the person that will help you do that. John said earlier he's going to bite off of me, so I'm going to bite off of him and say, I'm a coach. You know that person that tells you you can sprint and you say, I don't know how? I teach you how. Businesses fail because business owners don't know how to be in business. Most business owners think that they should start a business because they're passionate about it, but they don't know the requirements of business. How should a business behave? And how should you be a CEO in your business? I teach you those things. How do you behave in your business? And it's all about relationships. So if you want to be successful, if you want to find out how to make more money, how to be, do, and have everything that you've been looking for in your life, come see me.
Give her a hand. Yeah.
Amen. Amen. I come to you in the place of grace, mercy, and love. I'm Rose Parker, and I work with the state of Illinois. I work with people with disability. I'm employment resource specialist, which I am. My expertise is in marketing and advertising. I have a BSBA in marketing and advertising.
Go ahead, girl.
And also an MC in marketing communication, and then I have a MS in human services. And one of the things that I do, I try to get employers to partner with the state of Illinois to help people with disabilities. And one of my passions is ex-offenders. You know, neo-slavery is in the prisons. Amen?
Go ahead.
Amen. And that's the new slavery for manufacturers to come in to get their products made for $15 a month. Praise our God. Nevertheless, and I also have, I teach and I instruct and I insist our clients to be passionate about what you do, because if what you do is in this time and this season, you need to have your own. And I teach them how to start a business, how to maintain that business, entrepreneurship, because you can no longer work for the man and think you're going to prosper. The word of God says, even as your soul prosper, I want you to be in good health, so that hand in glove. Amen. So this is what I do. And also, I am in the process of starting Rehoboam Holistic Community Center. And Rehoboam means God has made room for you. And when God makes room for you, then you become fruitful. Amen.
Amen.
And so this center that we're looking to establish is open 24/7 and cover from the womb to the tomb. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what we're trying to do. Instead of you picking up a gun or you going out and commit domestic violence, you can come in, get some counseling, shoot some ball, do something, but you need not to take another African American or black man's life. Amen. Because we know that the black man carried the seed, and without the seed, there's no nation of people. So we have
to stop this
crime, black crime on black crime. And this is what I do. And one of the things that that we do, that people with disabilities, that is a hidden disability. And what the state of Illinois does, we will provide you training, and we will provide you education once you become qualified. So that means if you had a stroke or you have got injured on your job and you want to change your passion or change your career, then we will send you to school to get a master's degree, and the state of Illinois will pay for that. And that is a hidden secret that we don't know.
Yes,
so
yes.
When we come back for time and questions, then we can answer that.
Go ahead.
Well, following those people, right? The power and integrity of what I do is I'm like a Pied Piper. I go and get the youth, I go and get boots on the ground, brothers in the hood that don't have no knowledge of self. And the key to that is that what drives everyone in this room, whether they are aware of it or not, is your self-image. My name is Sadat Muhammad. I am the CEO and founder of Forever Together Brothers. I've been doing this for about 30 years. Most of my friends I've known since kindergarten. We do everything under the radar because to outthink your opponent, he can't be aware of what you are doing and the dynamics of resolution, how you replace the stimuli of audio, video, print media in the minds of our children. And we have to teach them military science. It's not that they don't know exactly what the ammunition or the gun or whatever it is what is the target or what are you securing? Is what they need to learn and understand. With that understanding comes meditation. Our children need to understand that their energy, their vibrational harmonics is something that sustains their lives, because you manifest from within you. What determines your life path, what determines what you're going to be, become, and what impact you're going to make on earth. What I love about Sister Sakira and the sister next to me is that I know that Sakira, when she talks about impossible, like Sister said earlier, those dynamics of words having energy and power give children an amplification and optimization of their mental acuity. They are in the killing fields in this educational system, which is teaching them belief and recall. It is not teaching them knowing and what spirit is. Belief does not mean that you know. So we have to give them the exact dynamics of all those social sciences. We have to cover academics, education, sociology, philosophy, psychology, economics, politics, and theology. They have to know that energy holistically has to be developed by them knowing that energy is INNER-G. That's the inner God within them. And once they have an awareness spiritually of their vibration and their resonance, then they'll determine their own life paths. That's what we have to teach our children.
Gordy's Foundation and C.H. Millery, which one is a nonprofit and the other is a profit. I started my business in Gordy's Foundation in 1998 when my son was gunned down drive-by shooting. And the foundation is named after him. And I was fighting God. And I got out on the street to find the young man that shot myself. God said, he's a jealous God. You can't love anything more than you love God. And he removed my son from me because that was my only child. I prayed for him for 10 years and I kept him 24 years. So he had to teach me that I had to love him more than I love my son. And I fought for a year before I decided to put Gordy's Foundation together. I was already in business. I've been in business for 40 years. And I ran beauty shops and barber shops those years. And I want to tell you this because I don't want to take up too much time, but we got mothers in the house. We talked to the doctor here earlier. Leave the door open for your sons to come in, regardless if they've been to the penitentiary or not. We all do wrong. I visit the penitentiaries all the time, and I talk to maybe some of you all sons to show them the right way. I got 5 or 6 trades in my school. I have carpentry, I have HVAC, I have custom maintenance, basic computer, barber school, silk screening, A-plus computer, industrial sewing. And I was awarded DDT, developmental disability training. And I am, as far as I know, if you go on the computer, like the lady said, and Google it, it's not the one black that has that program. And that's me. And it took me 2 years to fight against certain people to get that program. I'm here to help your sons because I don't have a son. I don't have a daughter. These trades are trades that I took up down through the years, not knowing what I wanted to do. And I came. I got out the hospital Tuesday. I fell up the steps. That sound funny. Tripped on my shoestrings and separated my shoulder and got a hairline fracture. But I was determined because I said, my word is my bond. I'm here in pain or not, I'm here. And I have a message to give. I thought maybe I was going to give it to a lot more people. But I think it's enough women in this room tonight. Leave your child where he can come to you, or she can come to you, Don't close the door on your child because he's been to the penitentiary and has stole all your money and all your clothes and everything else and sold them. Give him a chance. It's a second chance out here. I've been dealing with 15 years with ex-felons, ex-drug users, and handicapped people. Those are just like the people God put, you go to the Bible where they put them in a cage. The people that they put in the cage had leprosy. None of us wanted to be bothered. That's just like the ex-felons. We don't want to be bothered with them no more. And everywhere I go, I have to speak this. It's a desire in my heart. And I don't have no degrees. God, give me the sense and lead me and talk to me and tell me what I need to do. This is his program, not our rights program. Thank you.
Wow. I say wow. You know, up on this panel, we got all this knowledge and power. You know, I'm just a simple servant. I started out, I went to Dillard University, got my degree, worked in the private sector, made money, and my mom was always giving. She's always giving. So I was wondering, why is she giving? And I'm trying to gain. But it's not about the gaining, because God says it's easier for a camel to proceed through the eye of a needle than a rich man into heaven. So I left the private industry and joined the fire department. Came on, didn't have any clout, where black men weren't really wanted on that department. Today I sit here to say that I've been a help advocate of the department because I'm the ARF commander of a Midway airport for the fire department. No help, no clout. I'm part of the program, the CPTFA program, which stands for Chicago Police Fire and Training Academy, that gets young sophomores in this program to get them scholarships to go to college for free. So I want you all to hear this. So I know you got relatives that have children that are in high school. Don't be, I got cards, I'll pass them out. But, and that's just my side. But I decided to take on something else because I like helping people. And I shot a resume out there. And I had a friend of mine called me and says, hey, you need to go by Gordy's Foundation, man, because this lady is the real truth. Say, she, man, she helps so many people. He said, pull up her website on the web, like go to YouTube. So I punched it in and seen her interview with Harry Porterfield saying, someone you should know. I mean, this lady is the real deal. So I went in and she said, you know what, we're experiencing something. She trusted a Afro-American contractor to put the elevator in to help the handicapped people. This guy ran off with almost $200,000. Yeah, it makes your eyes water. So when I got there, my buddy says, hey man, you know, you negotiate, you know how to do things. The agency was stagnated. I went down to this architect that was working with this shabby, shoddy contractor and got this thing rolling again, you know, and I did it because God put that on me to do. You know, it's about us helping each other. We talk about, I got my car, just because you got your Benz or your Cadillac in your driveway, we ain't got none to everybody look like us, got a little something. People forget that. So I can say I'm proud to say I'm executive director of Gordy's Foundation, and I am glad to be here. And I love this to see us network. You see, they always show us as the negative side on the news. But see, they ain't got the media in here. They don't want our kids to see this positive message that you are better than a baggy pants sagging, gun-toting criminal thug. Yeah. You come from royalty, which is black royals. All these Nubian queens sitting up here and kings. This is what these kids need to see. I don't mean to get emotional, but I'm happy to be around you all because you are my family. And until we stand up to help our children, we gotta help them. Nobody, no agencies from the Europeans, we gotta go out there. It's a different approach. It's not like when we were coming up where you could spank everybody. You have to negotiate with them and tell them why they need to come in. Because they think they know it and they don't. God bless you all.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Derek Jones. I am Vice President of the Allied Workers Labor Union. And what that consists of is we unionize any labor, national and internationally. That's the first thing. Second thing, I have been a general contractor for over 13 years. I've did new construction. I've worked for companies like Hutton Construction out of Houston, building Family Dollar stores and from the ground up. I've worked for State Farm, Allstate Insurance, you know, doing rehabs, rehabilitation type projects on homes. I'm also a retired gang crimes drugs cop, which gave me a lot of compassion for the youth. I'm CEO of a record label in Chicago that I started here in Chicago a few years back called Power Mix Group One Entertainment Records. I know that's long, so we just call it PMG1. But what I do there, I'm profit, but not for profit. And what I mean by that is I have so many guys that are grinding and trying to get their music out and trying to get known. Nobody gives them a chance. Nobody opens doors for them. So I allow them to come into my label. I don't bind them in any contract because I do things out of sincerity in my heart. You know, I say, okay, they bring me the music. I let them put out their music. I give them the time period for their music. I give them their profits. It's just a vehicle. It's a door opening for them. I deal a lot of different venues, clubs, organizations. I sit on the Grammy board, and I sit on the EDM World Music Awards as well. So I do a lot with music, of course. I do a lot with the union. I believe I got a DJ tonight. You know, we got a big thing going tonight. So I do quite a bit. I'm surprised I'm still standing, but by the grace of God, he gives me this energy, he gives me this strength, he gives me this drive, and I'm just glad to be a part of. I mean, these people are geniuses. You know, I really admire everybody on here and respect what you guys do. We also are going to be working with Dr. Parker down here in an exchange program for people that, let's say if you have a certain type of disability, I'll bring you into the union, let you get a union card, temporary card, get out there, you learn to trade. A man, and I'm speaking from experience, a man wants to have something of his own. A man wants to take care of his own. And we consistently see how we as black men are being broke down and minimized. And we cannot continue to allow that. I saw a young man standing at the gas station, and he was asking me for a quarter. And I went to go give him the quarter. I said, but before I give you the quarter, I said, can I give you something else? And he's like, oh man, what? I said, come on now. I said, how old are you? He says, I'm 19. I said, you're 19 years old, and you're out here begging. Why are you out here begging? He said, because there's nothing out here for me. I said, why do you feel there's nothing out here for you? He said, well, nobody wants to help me. Nobody cares. So I got to do what I got to do, man. Can you just give me the quarter? I said, I'll give you the quarter, but I want to give you an opportunity as well as just giving you a quarter. So I prayed with this young man. You know, I spoke with him about different benefits and organizations. I sent him to a friend of mine that has a nice not-for-profit organization. I did check up on that guy a couple of days ago. He actually showed up. They're cleaning him up. He's got his first interview for McDonald's, you know, but it's enough. But I'm gonna pass it on. I know our time is short, so.
Are there any questions? Let me just elaborate. I was telling this young man here that we have to realize as the people of God, we are blessed to be a blessing. Amen? Amen. And the word of God said, without my people perish because of what?
Knowledge.
And you can't get knowledge without information. And you can't get information without communication. You know, Proverbs 4 and say that, and all thy getting get an understanding. But first before that, he said, wisdom is what? The principal thing. Meaning wisdom is the first thing. And to have wisdom at the beginning is to fear the Lord. Somebody said, do you believe God? I said, no, I don't believe him. I know him.
Right.
Amen. You have to go from belief to knowing what you do. As a people, we have to go from believing that we can and knowing that we can. can come up out of this if we unite ourselves together. And just like he said, you know, I work with people with disabilities. I help people. I believe in helping people. My son said, you're going to just give everything to you. You're going to be the baby on the street. I've been that baby on the street a lot of times. But I come back and give again. And people with disabilities and ex-offenders, and even we as a people, we get stuck in what we do. Amen. And we have to move out of that, what's the word I'm looking for? The spirit of lack or complacent, that's the word. We have to move out of complacent to moving forward. And we're going to only do that by knowledge, by networking, helping one another. One of the things with people with disability, even for those that are disability and at home, we call it home service. And if you need a PA or a CNA to come in and help you, then we will do that. But there's certain eligibilities that you have to meet, quote unquote, according to what the Fed said. But they're cutting back, you know, by me working with DHS, and one of the entities under DHS is the food stamp program. They're cutting back on food stamp. And even on public aid, you get 5 years of cash. I don't care if you have five babies or 555 babies. After 5 years, you get nothing but link. And after so many years of link, they're cutting back on that. So we have to move our people out of this, I call it a generational curse. My mama, my grandma, my great-great-grandmama was on public aid, so I'm going to continue to do that. Had a young lady the other day, you know, she had one baby, and then she came in and said, well, I need child support. And public aid said, well, you can't get child support from the second dad until you get it from the first dad. But the first dad is one who really gives. And that puts the black man into this thing of child support, and then you have baby mama drama, amen? And I just believe that some men really want to take care of their children, and I see them taking care of their children, but the government, and we quote unquote as ladies, we get caught up of greed, and it has to stop. It has to stop, and it has to come by knowledge. We have to unite all these resources that's in this room, because we all geniuses, amen? We're all geniuses, because after that sperm is ejected into the female, only one survived. And out of that one, you the genius that came forth to give back to the community and give back to the human race. Amen?
Amen.
I
got a question for the audience. In this panel, we have six of us up here. And in this room, we probably got another 50 people. Most of the time when I'm facilitating an event like this, I ask everybody to pull out their business card. So how many people in here have a card? Several of you, right? Have you heard something that somebody you know could use? Yes? Is there a person on this panel that you think should talk to you or someone you know? Okay, let's make this an action type of thing. So right now, while you're thinking of the person or yourself, if you got a question for the panelists, or you got a person you know that needs the services you see, let's make it happen right now, not tomorrow. So let's do it right now. Think about it, okay? Valencia, one person you know or you need a service from. You either need a service from one of us or somebody you know. Give me the person's name. We're gonna make it so it's real. You want to write for Diversity MBA Magazine. Okay, so that's done. And you already have my card. Yes? Here's what you do with the business card. Take your card and put on the back, I need to talk to Secura about X, Y, and Z. Or if you see on this panel, I need to talk to this young lady. And hand her the card so that it's an actionable item. Because we will leave here and we will forget. But if we make it something that's happening today, people will start to move it forward. This is a great panel. We got some people that got power. Let's see, the lady in the purple right here. Yeah, you. Have you heard anybody that might be something you need or somebody you know that needs? Not yet. What do you do? Because maybe somebody can help you.
Let me ask you a question. Is there anyone in this auditorium that, and I'm quite sure it is, because I don't believe there's nobody in this auditorium that don't have somebody in their family that is an ex-felon, an ex-drug user, or trying to get off of drugs. You can send them to Gordy's Foundation. I, and not only that, I have a
lot of my success stories on YouTube. Put in God is Foundation, and you will see what God is Foundation has did to help a person to get off of, what is it, not cocaine.
Heroin.
He's on YouTube, okay? So mostly every family in the United States got somebody in the family that's using drugs or have used drugs, is fighting to stay off of drugs, or an ex-felon that can't find a job. We help place those people. We even give them life skills, train them and mentor them. We do all those things for the young men. Do you realize we're not going to have no good young men for our granddaughters? They're going to all be in the penitentiary. If we as parents don't start standing up, don't be ashamed. I'm not ashamed of nobody in my family. If you a hooker, you a hooker. That's my family. I can talk about my family, but I also try to help my family. So why don't just sit here like a log? I know there's somebody in here that knows somebody in your family down the line or your next door neighbor.
I'm gonna make a sincere bond and promise, actually. The reason why I came from out of the matrix was because not only the success behind what we've developed at Forever Together Brothers, but I do it very privately because if we look at the system that's in place to possess the indigenous African mind, it's developed by what the stimuli effectively gives you as how you view yourself and self-image. If we're on Real Basketball-wise, Real Housewives of Atlanta, basketball girls, bad girls, and they see our sisters can't get along, throwing drinks on each other, hollering and screaming, can't even hold a conversation, this image is projected in the minds of those who watch this reality and process. The hypnotic aspect of the psychotechnology of brainwashing is developed by a system of the people in charge. Here it is, they're giving you something for nothing in the greatest free enterprise system on the planet. So here it is that we have to look at little boys, the key to little boys. They already unify in sports from the beginning. Boys have always had an integration and an effective collective rapport with one another. If it's a gang leader that provides food, clothing, and shelter, or some kind of affection or concern for me, then my loyalty is to him. If he don't get it at home in his environment where he told to sit down, little boy, go outside and play, get away from me, stay in the child play, shut up because we don't want you to talk and say nothing because adults are talking right now, then the shrieking violent aspect of that physical, mental, and verbal abuse on him, he takes to school, he takes to any other areas and playground areas. Effectively, his experience in that mental process of spirit and vibrational energy isn't developed because we don't know. We're on belief and recall. Everything in this universe has a vibration. The most powerful energy that you use every day, most people ain't even aware of. And most of y'all use it every day. So this is what I tell young men. I go and tell him, not only is his value and him being an asset for us as a nation and a culture, but what is it that he sees within himself, the self-image that hasn't developed, that he has that value? We have to give it to them. We have to allow your son. You have to train your son for your granddaughter, and then he'll be a man. You can't send that little boy outside and train that girl. You take her to the store. You teach her how to balance her checkbook. She looks at how her mother dresses. She looks at how her mother engages people in conversation. But you done sent your son outside to play. See?
Can I add something to that? Because the other piece that we want to talk about is fathers, daughters, mothers, and fathers. Because when he's talking about us training our young men, who's training our daughters? Who's training these young women to learn how to be women? Most of us don't think about the fact that by the age of 8, we formed our personality. But between the ages of 8 and 14, a young girl learns how to be a woman. And most of it, she learns from her father.
Absolutely.
Whilst we think that what we see is what teaches the woman,
how to be a woman, what really teaches a woman how to be with a man, is her dad.
That's right.
And if 59% of our homes don't have one in one, then our young women never learn how to behave with a woman, with a man, and how to be a woman. So then when we go forward into our future, and we as mothers are mad at our fathers, as the fathers, or quote unquote, baby's dad. We have an issue with him, but our dad was never there. So now we're all looking for dad to come back and teach us how to be a woman. And I'm 40 years old, and I'm still trying to understand. And that man who I had that baby by, and that other man, who messed me up, and then I teach my daughter. And then my daughter turns around, and what does she do? Have a baby when she's 12 or 14 or 16 or 18. And now she's got these babies, and who is she going to look to? So we got to get the brothers, because they're the ones that are going to teach the mothers, who are going to teach the daughters and raise the sons. So all of this that we're talking about on this stage is a cycle. I call it the cycle of perpetual paradox, belief and behavior that limit our society and cause us to continually have the problems we have. So when you hear a brother like this that's talking about young brothers, he's also talking about young mothers. Because if those brothers don't learn how to be men, they will never be the men to their daughters, so their daughters can be the mothers to their sons. And they'll never be the husband. African American women are more likely to never get married than any other race in the world. 79% of all African American women will never be married. 59% of them who get married and get divorced will never remarry. Ever. So what will our boys know? What will our girls know? What will our grandchildren know? I'm a grandmother of 15 children. I'm a mother of 6 boys and 2 girls. This is serious to me. So when you guys sit out there, we're asking you, do you need our help? We're asking because we care. We are here because we know that when you go back to your neighborhood, you're going to see what we see. Little boys standing on the corner. Standing on the corner because they have nowhere to go. Because our men are in prison, and so they can't find their role model. And their little girls are looking for that man who teaches her how to be with a man. So when you get to be 16, or 26, or 36, and you're still asking that man, how do I look? Am I beautiful? Do you like this? Is it what you want? Who is asking that question? That's that little girl. That's that little girl. So he's telling you about those boys who are going to grow up and never learn how to show that little girl how beautiful she is, how important it is. Never learn that he is supposed to value these women and marry these women and father his children, because he never learned it.
And the powerful aspect of that is her and I both have large families. I have 6 daughters. I'm my daughter's guy until she's 16 years old.
Yes.
There hasn't been any breaches in the integrity of that relationship because they understand the principles with their father that respect and integrity builds powerful relationships. So her honoring me as her dad and me securing her until I think she's developed enough mature aspect in our interaction together, then I'll allow her to understand that process and structure will enrich her life because she has the tools to absolutely look at a relationship between man and woman. But I learned from my mother. See, it works in the reverse. Little boys have to engage in interaction with their mother and relationships that determine their respect for her, how he honored hers with loves and concern, as well as what I need to act and how I need to be when it comes to that other energy. Now, what I teach children is, and why I stay under the radar, actually, is I teach them sacred secret sciences that the same people that are in power use to take over planet Earth. That's what I do. And what's been accomplished by it is that those determining factors get our children away from belief and recall into knowing and thinking and spirit. And those are the things that you have to give a soul and spirit upon this earth. And that's how it strengthens itself to be able to be resilient by no matter what dynamics come, because it has the mental acuity and the vibrational harmonics to sustain its own life. That's what we have to teach our children. And that's why my little brothers, I'm going to absolutely amplify us at this time, because it's finally gotten to the level where I think we'll be embraced in our awakening aspect of how we get out. Most of these brothers are CEOs. They have their own businesses. I have aviators that fly jets off of aircraft carriers. I have brothers that are boots on the ground that are doing systematic things as couriers and attachés for governments. So when little brothers are sitting with these gentlemen and looking at how they were on 47th Street, 39th Street, 63rd Street, in the hoods, off Gill Gardens, and that they've achieved something at a different level that most people don't see in black male dynamics, then that gives them the motivation to unify, which is what the first law in the universe is, unity. It's the most powerful law in the universe. The sub-law, which is the 14th law, is the law of attraction. There are laws and principles that are right now being applied with every other generation that we haven't had, because they systematically control us in academics, education, economics. See, we stayed married at a 90%. When Roosevelt did a study on us from 1933 to 1938, 90% of us stayed married. See, I seen my great-grandmother, great-grandfather, my grandfather, my grandmother, and my mother and father. So I've always had those intricate dynamics in there because we were taught to think outside the box. That's what we have to do to our children. We can't keep sending them to the killing fields of our enemy, male or female. We have to teach our own children. We can't be lazy with the bloodline that is the most valuable asset that the people in power are using against us. The Fords wouldn't do that. The DuPonts wouldn't do that. The Rothschilds wouldn't do that. The Oppenheimers, the Warbucks, the Schiffs, people y'all don't even know about. Families rule this planet, not governments. So we have to be family. You know, we have to have our sisters and brothers collectively unify with all the talents and ability we have, and in pooling their resources, we can shift this stuff overnight. But we have to have trust issue with each other. We have a sinister, skeptical aspect of each other because of audio, video, print media. Whoever controls the media controls your mind. So we have to replace that stimuli with our own media. So I come in with principles and laws for children to understand that the value that they have in their mind determines that they're in a mind war. How do you become a mind warrior? How do you exercise that aspect of mental acuity and thought and create the vibrational harmonics in your spirit that determines your life path? I tell three-year-olds that. You understand? You have to have your children have a thinking application so that they can secure their lives. It is not outside of them. It comes from within. Children have to be in an area and be calm and quiet and meditate. That's like prayer. If we're Christians and we pray, teach them children how to pray with an aspect of meditation that lets them know that they are valuable in the eyes of God universally. Different child. Different child. I go and get children, boots on the ground. I got my own office in King College Prep and had some white department heads removed from the school because of their they were so insensitive and insincere about brothers just a posture in the chair getting put out of his classroom. A student, maybe he might have been on his game system all night or something. He couldn't sit up straight that day. But you put him all the way out the room because I'm just not going to have that in my... That plantation mentality is something we have to give our children tools for. They have to know how to respond to the police. You know, they can't be looking all up, frowning, and doing all that messing with the police and don't want to turn around and all that, because they're going to get locked up, create a record, then here's another problem. If they honor their mother and father, when there's another adult thing, they'll know how to address it with the proper mental acuity, because we trained them to do that. See, and that's what we have to do. As a father, I love my daughters. They're my babies. See, my wife is me outside myself in female form.
That's right.
And respecting her, I have to have the balance and the center coming from her by shutting up sometime and listening to my wife. Because she's not telling me anything wrong. It's not critical when she comes out of concern and tell you something that you don't want to hear that you need to know. We all have to do that with each other. See, as a neighbor, I say something to everybody's kids. I don't care if their mama cussed me out, because I know that's her problem. I'm trying to save that bloodline that might save her. So it's important that I say something when you got your drawers down. You know, it's important when y'all smoking Kush crops, I'm walking past you and you know better. You know how Brother Muhammad get down. What's up with that, brother? You know? So we have to step up to the plate and have a desire to save ourselves first, to save planet Earth. And we have to do it with our direct bloodline by showing them examples that are out of the box. Pavlov, Erickson, Jung, and Freud ain't got nothing to do with the indigenous African mind. Ain't nothing to do with us. You dig? So we have to tell them real stuff. And it's dangerous, to be honest with you, because sometimes you could be in an environment where people are assessing what you're doing to create a problem for them. See? So my learning and naval intelligence, because I didn't beat my own horse, but I was a high school and college All-American. When I left high school, I went to Yale. They hated me. Every day I was battling the slave owners' children and the alumni that was in the order, Illuminati, Skull and Bones. I learned about that in 71, 72. See, so I knew I had to come back to my boy in the hood that's on the Kush crops and tell him, hey, bro, there's people out here that are monetizing their minds intergenerationally and passing it to their descendants. So it's important for them to understand that family is what rules this planet. Not what somebody taught us that don't even like us. We sending our children to the killing fields of a school environment that is trying to vilify them. They're the first people to get punished disparagingly. They're the first people to get medicated because the mom say, well, they must be telling what's going on because he won't sit down at home. See, the black mind is amplified and it's accelerated. We have to have the materials that give them the type of things that are comfortable for them to use that powerful mind they have. They don't have it in this public food system.
No.
It's impossible. See? So we got work to do. First thing we do is, like Sakira and his sister say, we have to unify. If I got some information, you know, I'm not going to point it or hoard it or something, because everybody that I'm trying to save looks like me. So I have to have love of self for my self-image to go get my brother or to go get my sister and tell her when she's wrong. Then I have to have honor, a wife and a family that supports me as a man. And I'm determined to provide for them because it's reciprocity that has to be developed between us. And we don't do that with each other. And we have to have our own businesses and start quality businesses with superior products and services. Right now, my 11-year-old runs her own business. My son, 15, he's the chief operations officer of my corporation. They have to do that now from elementary school and high school, develop corporations and businesses, understand board of trustees, board of directors, who's the chief financial officer, what it is I need to do as a business plan, a business proposal, how do I acquire grants, what can I do with people that have the expertise and unify with me so we can have long-term development. I teach children that now. That's what we have to do. And when you have people who do it, you can't sit in an audience without any questions. You can't sit there and actively not give me a reciprocity and energy from you having interest for all of us to succeed as a nation and a culture. That's what we got to do.
And what I get out of that from Brother Muhammad is that 99.9% of the businesses that say father and son, and nothing against Europeans or European based. We got to turn those numbers around to say African-American. And also, when he talks about this energy to put in our we got to go in the neighborhood, you all. We can't sit back and talk about what's wrong and go to our churches and be rivals with other churches. We got to talk to our pastor to get out there and say, hey, man, we talking about what the news is doing. This is what we need to do. These are our neighborhoods. So we got to get out there and move around some. So everybody sitting here, I know you're a member of some type of church that's a mega church, because everybody want to go to the big church and wear the fur coat. So we need to tell the pastor, Pastor, look here, let's go to Englewood this week. Let's go on the west side next week.
Let's go to Roseland.
Let's go to Gresham. We need to do this. Let's go, what did they call it, Tarrytown?
But as black people, let's be honest. As a group of blacks, we do not stick together.
That's right.
We don't stick together. We are so busy trying to pull each other down. You can get one dime more than the person next to you. And I'm with them, they will chop your legs off. And this is what my problem is here. I funded my own program, okay? I took every dime I had and I sold my building and went to Englewood to help the young men take the guns out their hand from killing other people's kids.
Holes in concrete, put a hole in it and cement it what? Cement it over.
I'm just going to comment, these people have forgotten the skills our ancestors had. That's really all it is.
Right.
You know, they had to hide assets, a lot of other stuff, is how they... The only other comment, Lee, I wanted to add, Lee.
Yeah.
I have young men that walk through the door and got their pants up under their butts. No, you don't walk in here like that, honey. I will get me a piece of material and tie that those pants around your waist till you leave here. You cannot come in my building. Your man came in and do some cleaning from the welfare. The welfare deal, they put you to work for those food stamps. And he got nappy hair all over his head. And I got a guess. Cook County Congressional Senator sitting there. He come in looking like a boogie man. I pulled his coattail right there. That's the way I am. You see, nobody gives me money, so you can't pull strings on me. When they give you money, politicians want to pull strings on you, tell you what to say and how to do it. You can't tell me that. When God get ready for me to stop doing what I'm doing, he can stop. Nobody else ain't gonna stop me. And I'm going to help your child, because I don't want to see no mother in this world have to feel the pain I feel every day. I cry every day and don't be crying. So if you ain't been there, you need to get up off it and start trying to join somebody, to help somebody else's child, because God going to bless you. All you have to do is reach back and pick somebody else up.
I just want you guys to, if anybody can share or answer this question, because there's a misconception in our country about people who have a felony being able to vote. And as you know, we have upcoming elections, and even though it is power that be, are trying to create situations where people of color have a hard time voting anyway.
They can vote in my building. The only person that can't get a license for barber school is a sex offender. Okay? Sex offenders cannot get a license.
They can vote. And just to piggyback what she said, for ex-offenders, if they come out, it depends on what their crime was, they can go into IDS, better known as the unemployment office, and get bonded, where they can get employed. The state of Illinois had a program called reentry program. Governor Quinn cut the funds for that, so that's no longer in existence. But that was a very, very successful program. And we as a people, we have to come together and help our inmates and our ex-offender that has come out of jail and looking for employment. I grant you there's some that don't want it. If you don't want to, keep on stepping, move on. Let somebody else come to the front of the line that wants to do that. And, you know, train up a child in the way he should go. When he's old, he won't depart. The family was the first institution that God
created. And it's the enemy's job, Satan, Lucifer, whatever you want to call him, to rob, kill, steal, and destroy. That's his job. Now look in the mirror and say, mirror, mirror on the wall, who am I? Mirror on the wall, why am I? And what am I on this planet for? We have to train our children, and we have to help each other. We got to do this to save our people. African Americans are no longer the majority of the minority. We're the minority of the minority. Hispanics have come up and took the line. When there was an immigration issue, they came downtown Chicago in 3,000 strong and shut it down. And guess what? They got what they wanted. But we have, as a people, we have to come together and unite to get what we want that's rightfully ours. You know, we can no longer say, my mama, my grandmother. You know, if you look at the lineage of Christ, there was whole prostitutes, murders, and anything else you want in. You know, so where are we today? Why did he shed his blood? What is our purpose? To help each other. You know, I too, you know, have raised four sons and had one to go to jail. In fact, I turned him in. Because I said, I ain't going to have nobody chasing you down like a dog. And went down to get him. And they said, well, Miss Parker, you know, he pulled a gun on you. I said, so what? And he said, what you going to do? I said, I know how to get a prayer through. You don't have to wake up in the morning. Because I know the power of prayer. And you got to have that stand in you to do that, to fight for your children, to fight for each other. It takes a whole village to raise a child. But we no longer live by that. We no longer live by that. And we have to come back to the old base. And we have to come back to our foundation. And let me just close with this. With the state of Illinois, if you have a child that's in school in special ed, we help them too. That's transitional. That's a STEP program. And when they get 18, they come to an adult program. And like I first said, depending on what their goal, what they want to be in life, if you want to be a social worker, then we will pay for your master's degree. If you have the capabilities of doing that coursework, if you need a trade or a training, we would do that. And we're partnering with Mr. Derek Jones to help us. And I just informed her that the state of Illinois will pay you later to train. So we need to get some of this money. Amen. So we can move forward as a people, to move forward as a community. All of us is a whole. We are whole and we make one. We're one body, you know, to do different things. Amen?
Amen.
We got a question right here. I just want to know, Ms. Wright, how you feeling?
Positive,
negative,
depressed,
how you feeling?
I'd like to give everybody an assignment to start this revolution we're about to do. I want everybody, and I mean this, so we can start this, because it's got to start somewhere. I want you to go to your alderman. If you don't know who they are, or he or she is, find out, and tell them that you want to visit the firehouse. Let me tell you why, because I've had some kids come into the firehouse. I worked on the west side. I've had the privilege to work all over the city, and even the most callous children, once they come in there and sit in that fire truck and walk around, and it's amazing. I mean, it changes them, and they want to become firemen. See, the reason our kids don't know anything about that, because we didn't raise them up in the firehouse. See, I had the privilege to bring my son to the firehouse to stay overnight. And man, he's going for a sport medicine degree. He's got a couple semesters left, and he'll be a sport medicine doctor. So that's why I tell you, bring them somewhere. They have that privilege. Let's take them out the neighborhood where things are dormant and dead, to somewhere where things are happening so they can see that.
No, I was just going to add in a little off the beaten path, but if you have any projects or anything going on in your communities and in your neighborhood where you don't see us, people of color, please let me know. Because that's a hard thing to deal with when you got so many unemployed men and women out here that need jobs. There's construction, new construction, streets being built, things being done in their own community, and they're not allowed to work. I think that is ridiculous. You know, how can you tell them, hey, there's stuff out here for you, and they walk through the community and they don't see themselves or somebody that resembles them working those jobs or building those buildings? let me know this. I mean, this is one of the things that the labor union that I belong to fights for. We really do. We have one, there is only, I'm pretty sure you guys don't know, there is only one major black contractor, one that has the capability of dealing with roads and highways. There's only one. And do you know they will not give him the work? So we're fighting for him against the AFL-CIO to make sure that he has everything. I mean, he's qualified for everything, the proper bonding. He's submitted all the proper paperwork. It's just he's not a part of that good old boy network. And they told him, said, well, yeah, you can come in and work, but you got to use our people and let go of your people. He's like, what do you mean? These are my employees. These are black men and women that need work. We have nothing to do with that. You got to use our people.
We have 500 jobs, truck drivers, right now, and I've been putting them through. I've got a whole box full. I have a TV program I host on KN21 on Thursday night at 5:30. I was on 102.3. These jobs, is it coming through Inglewood to my building? Now I'm partnered with someone else for Kelly, and who is that?
Manpower.
And they have jobs that will come through Inglewood. You don't have to live in Inglewood to come to Boys Foundation to put in for a job. You come in and put in this application, and I fax it off. And if you go by what's on this paper here, you'll get that truck driver. And if you don't have your license, you can't come to this. This is important because there are a lot of truck driving jobs that, a lot of companies that we are dealing with. I can't divulge that. All they told me I could do is tell you about it. So I almost forgot it.
Well, here's what they do. They're based out of Vegas, and what they did, they came and they partnered with us. They send for you, they give you a ticket to come there. All you have to do is show up. They'll pay you while you're in school. What it is, the industry, if you notice, the industry is ran by air, sea, land, and rail. The boat can only carry it so far. The plane can only land on the runway, and the ship can only come to the dock. So those goods and merchandise that are needed throughout to serve, they have to be trucked to wherever they need to go. And right now, there's like almost, they're gonna need, by 2015, they're gonna need something like 20 million truck drivers.
Wow.
By 2015. So we've got 500 jobs waiting and available right now at Gordy's Foundation. And like Mrs. Wright stated, you don't have to live in Inglewood, just come on in. People of color, I encourage you to please come. And if you've ever driven a truck, I know some of us hate to be away from home from our sweetie pie, but they got a run called a Dakota run. That's the oil run. You can make $50,000 every 4 months.
Let me ask you another question. All right, lady.
But that's my point, see, and that's why it's certainly on us in terms of information. This is one of the greatest free enterprise system on the planet. It's right here in the United States. We are on social networks, on Facebook, and texting And yet the technology for the information like this is all over the internet, actually. Because we know people, Nubian and I, who run those contracts all the time. $50,000 every 3 months. They do the oil and the fracking and all that type of stuff. And we know some brothers who are actually doing that. But this is the key. We have been taught on belief and recall. I'm trying to get y'all to really look at this. We've been instructed on belief and recall. If it ain't on that board, what they say for you to put on that paper or what they give you to study in their books in gradation, we're talking about from pre-K to 12th grade. The first grade has to have this, second grade has to have this. It's programmed, see? And so there's an analyzation that has to take place. Well, how are we training our youth to think? See, we have to use countermeasures. The Jewish school, the kindergarten, costs $25,000 a year. Kindergarten. What are they teaching their children? Do you understand? So they're teaching them how to rule the world with all the social dynamics that we don't even train our children to do. We'd rather have Disney babysit them, Nickelodeon, or some game system or something. We go and run and get all the 2K games, the new Air Jordans is out, the Air Force Ones. We keep giving our children trinkets. I'm gonna tell you what they tell me directly, you know, and why I had some parents take a couple of little boys out of our program because she felt like we had too much influence over her sons. I said, first of all, me and him walk down to the end of the beach and sit under the tree and talk. He wants to know, why am I here, Brother Sadat? What is it can I do? Do you know anything that I might be interested in? Then you engage him in dialogue, but what are you interested in? What is it you see? What do you think that might be something that you could be drive your passion or something? And engaging that right there alone, he gives you, as an adult, more juice for interacting with him, human to human, spirit to spirit, flesh to flesh, than a gym shoe or a game system ever does. They play with that stuff for a week. They don't even want it no more because they want their parents' attention. They want to know how it feels to be hugged, how it feels to be talked to, how it feels to be have someone that has some concern about you. Yeah. Like I say, he don't get it in the house, then he gonna get it from my guy on the corner. That's gonna get him to be a lookout. That's gonna get him to move some of this work. That's gonna get him to disrespect his sister because they think they pimps and hustlers. You know, so we have to provide countermeasures for them. Information is the most valuable asset we can ever have right now. It's information. So we have to use that social network, not from Facebook, but to see if there are some jobs that are interstate or national or international. They have jobs international right now. Did y'all know that most of us can go to Cuba and go to school free? Be a doctor, engineer, you can go into upper master degree programs, finance, economics, free. Just because we look like them. How many of us use the program? They got a program at Harvard. If you are low income, you on what, Section 8, or you have a link card, but your baby got the mental acuity, of course, I don't recommend it, because I'm not going to send the cream of my crop to my oppressor, my enemy, and that's what we've been doing. That's why the Greeks created the sororities and fraternities, actually, because it's driven by Sigma Silgar Pi, Sigma Pi Phi. And that could be the Boule or anybody else. So you have organizations even in our community you're unaware of.
Yep.
See, that are gatekeepers that get paid very well to hold our people back or to incite riots or to have them do something like that. I've yet to see a facility this large that ceasefire has put in place and they've had about $18 million in the last 4 years. Where's it at? Where's it at? Are we training brothers in carpentry, plumbing, electrician? Are we training brothers in economy and economics and how to provide portfolios like Brother Lee Ward has been doing all that time? What are we doing? We don't never scream on our own people. Sometimes we have to chastise our own and develop a real relationship by letting them know, hey, brother, we're watching you. So if this ceasefire and stuff, and you can get these gangs to put down these guns, how are we going to train them like the essays do over in Humber Park and Logan Square? Rahm Emanuel gave them a full facility. Because like Sister said, when they call for a meeting, this right here should be filled with a brother like Lee Warren and Sakira here, these brothers and sisters here. It should be packed. Our people should be standing on the wall. You understand? But we like basketball-wise. We like Real Housewives in Atlanta. See, we like to sit around with sport and play with these gladiators that be broke after they leave the NFL, NBA, Major League Baseball. See, to us, my little brothers just had a debate
Jackie Robinson, Larry Doby, to them, they weren't their heroes, they was traitors. The largest free enterprise we ever had, they sold out on. Brothers were multimillionaires and owned many of the stadiums, the baseball stadiums in this nation. So who gave us him as a hero? This is what Shorty's is asking me. Y'all gotta have some answers for them. You understand? They know who S.B. Fuller is. How many of y'all here know who S.B. Fuller is? You understand? Look at all the old school people, see? Most of our people don't have a clue who he was. See, extraordinary entrepreneur who put a lot of people in business that were black. See, that's why it's called Bronzeville. We had banks, gas stations, grocery stores, restaurants. You talk about Isola, Jackie's, Gladys's. You know, you talk about real stuff. And we were purchasing, our dollars stayed in our community more than any other ethnic group. Now, everybody's coming in our community, coming independently wealthy. See, because if Dr. Lee Warren has a product, or Sadat has a product, well, bro, you know that costs too much, you know. Or my sister, my restaurant, y'all took too long with my food, so I'm finna leave. But they'll sit outside the Olive Garden or Red Lobster for an hour and get them all the money they want. So we have to call each other and check each other on what we develop and do, and have to do it with the love and sincerity of each other. I should be able to go to my brother. Okay, we can argue, fuss and fight. Come on, brother, let's go and get something to eat now. Come on. You know, I ain't got to shoot you. I ain't got to bust you in your face. I ain't got to jump up and down on you like the game system. I took my son out of high school this week. Because not only when I talk to the little brothers about them wanting to whoop him over a girl, but the ferocity they had, just the way they were spitting and cussing and hollering to talk to me. And it took a lot for me not to grab one of them and hurt her, because I'm a martial artist. I'll beat you up. And I train children to beat people up so they won't be bullied. But the key is am I doing it out of sincerity and love for myself? See? So that's what we got to do now. We have to continuously look at the aspects of how do we have our own self-image. What do you think about yourself? What do you think? What is it about you that you don't love? You know? Why are you smoking? You know you're going to die. Why are you poisoning yourself with foods and drugs? You know you're going to be out of here. Why aren't you breathing? I teach children how to breathe. 80% of your oxygen goes to your head, your brain. It manufactures electricity, so your respiratory, circular, your motor skills can stay strong and strengthened. We have health challenges in our community because we refuse to eat the proper food. We refuse to discipline ourselves with the proper diet. You know that you ain't got no business eating meat. We don't have the teeth for it. You don't have no claws for it. You don't have no acidic stomach. You're on an alkaline-based system. You have molars. There's nothing canine about your teeth. See? And then you wonder why you walk around with this girth, but what it is it's just all the meat you've eaten all your life. You know, it's called elimination. So we have to eliminate a lot of stuff, mentally, physically, and spiritually. And its development is that honoring our women, because we were in a matriarchal society, by the way. Our sisters ran our civilizations. See? Most men don't know that, because when the Caucasian came out of these caves, he brought that alpha thing in. Steel and fire to create war all over planet Earth. See? They know it. They know it was designed for it. The ancient universities in Timbuktu, we taught the Greeks and the Arabs. Most people, I ain't no Muslim. I'm a universally spiritualist. You know why? Because the Ottoman Empire enslaved us from the 8th century. Islam is an enemy on this planet. Actually, y'all didn't even know that, did you? They cut our brothers and sisters' heads off if they didn't submit to Islam. Then they sold us to the Christians. You understand? I had an issue with them as well. That's just keeping it real. So our children have to be mind warriors. They can't keep being indoctrinated by rituals and traditions of people that don't even like us.
Any questions, challenges, or statements?
I want to ask Ms. Parker about the program in the state of Illinois. Does it help veterans, disabled veterans? And I also want to know if can
go back to college and the state of Illinois pays for it?
No. With our program, DRS, Division of Rehab Services, we work with people with disabilities. You have to have a disability. And then if you have that disability, then there are certain guidelines that you become eligible before we can do that. There are certain guidelines that the federal government does. In fact, we're the only agency in the state of Illinois that we're funded federally by.
Is that age requirement for that?
No. Yeah, I'm cervix. You know, the ironic thing, you know, I have three clients that have PhDs, God forgive me, but they knew me as a tutor. You know, and I don't know why, but I'm thinking they're, it's because of their disability, but it depends on your goal. It depends on what you want to do and whether you're capable of doing that.
Veterans.
We will help veterans get employment, assist to get employment, but we won't spend the federal dollar. The Veteran Administration, they have to be disabled. They have to be disabled. We work strictly with people with disability. But then you go over to IDES, the Unemployment Office, and they will help you get employment. They have a resource room. They do what I do. They teach you how to resume, how to dress, how to interview. And interviewing is a skill. It's art, and you got to know how.
And to add to that,
veterans will pay
apply and we get a federally funded loan to
start a business. Do they have that for the new veterans?
No, I don't.
Guys from Afghanistan?
No, no, they don't. Yeah. You know, they have cut back so much with that.
Entrepreneurs that have, a couple of them have been contractors, and I met them at the Green Festival. And then some other people, because I know there are programs in the city, but I'm wondering if you're aware of any money for, you know, not just jobs, but people who want to get into green businesses.
There's actually two programs, one which I'm sure everybody heard about. This one isn't green, but I want to remember to talk about the new digital hub that's going to be done that President Obama just passed, and it'll be down, was it
Goose
Island? Pay attention. If you want to get into the digital and technology era, there's going to be opportunities to open smart businesses that are actually going to be technology savvy. So that's one way to go. But there is green funding that's available. There's an incubator for small businesses that start green businesses, and I want to say it's on like 26th and California.
It's down in Little Village.
Yes, yeah. It's in Little Village, and it's strictly for green business. All they do is incubate small businesses that are in the green area. So if you want to do something that's green manufacturing or have a green business, that's where you're going to go. They have funding to support your business, and they actually do training on how to build your business. So it would be a good place to go.
And then you also can go to SBA. They will help you, and they have all the funding, and then they have all the resources that you can help and teach you how to network to get those grants.
You can also go on the computer and put in grant .gov or down the line.
Grant.gov.
And you go down the line and look at each category, housing, everything, and go in and sit down and read what would fit you, and then sit down and look at grant.
And then if you need someone to help you write grants, just make sure you see me. I have two people who write grants, and they actually get the funding. You know, that's all they do. They have businesses that all they do is write grants for businesses and for nonprofits, and I can put you in contact with them. They will help you write your grant to go after those funds that are available.
And see, that's what I mean by information. This is the key, right? When you have people like these that are up here, that are around you, and have that type of information, we have to utilize and systematize that information to benefit us. We can fund ourselves. The Korean Association does it. The Hispanic La Raza community does it. We have to start pooling our resources from wasting money with garbage, for instance. A lot of us are eating too much fast food. That's a health challenge. Some of that money we could pool the resources with and start some training activities amongst ourselves and fund it, and then we don't have to be impeded by bureaucracy or red tape by people because we're doing it ourselves. Every other culture is in our community becoming independently wealthy because we refuse to unify. This unwillingness for us to work with each other, it has us in the predicament we're in. There's a trust issue that we have to get past with each other because we have to own up to making our word bond. If you're going to say you're going to be someplace at a particular time, I'm supposed to meet you there and you took my business card, then I expect to meet you there. That's a time-wasting practice when you develop a stand-up or a leave somebody hanging clause in how you think. We do it all the time because you think that something else is more important by kicking it with the homies instead of securing your life and enriching the people around you from the experience they have with you. We got to do that. So the first week of April on the weekend at the Theo Bowman Center, Spiritual Center on 80th and Woods, we're having our conference. I am one of the chief operation officer of the creation and conservation of wealth. That's how I put young people to work and teach them about business security because they have to have businesses. Let's stop trying to get them to look for employment and go to school to come back with this job slavery. To be a higher paid slave, the first to get fired, the last to get hired, because we don't have no businesses that we qualify for them to be employed by ourselves. Our youth are 60 to 80% unemployed. That's why they out boots on the ground. They're trying to figure it out. They want a smartphone like the white kids on Nickelodeon that they see every day. They want to wear nice clothes because they got peer pressure. So they get out and hustle stuff, and sometimes you don't even know what your child on because you don't even interact with that soul and spirit on this earth. So that's what we're doing. We got enough information for everybody in here to 100% employ our people.
There were a couple of questions. You had a question, sir? Oh. Yeah. I'm going to be speaking next. Very, very well.
Basically, what I was interested in, sort of what I've been complaining about, I reside on the north side, but I was born on the south side. And pretty much, I see infrastructure ignoring the African American community. Rahm Emanuel just cut out the south side from the broadband that Governor Quinlan promised the south side. So what I was interested in doing was trying to bring about PCB manufacturing training and certification programs and market credit TIF areas on the south and west side of Chicago, training the African American community how to design tablet computers, smartphones.
Wait, here's what we're doing.
We're on a time thing. That's Martin O'Shea, who is the next speaker, but we're going to do. But he's not only the next speaker, but he interacts with us, with the PM, but he's got questions because you all stimulate not only him, but the whole group. So what we're going to do now in lieu of our time, we're going to start with this gentleman right here and let him give us some closing remarks and work our way to Secura.
Well, I'd like to first thank you guys for having us out here and having me out here. Again, if you see any type of labor, anything going on in your communities and it's not employing a good percentage of us there, that's unfair. I give you my card, what I have here, what I have left, I get it to you. Also, you know, I'm in agreement with the brother down here, you know, about sharing wealth back into the community. I brought the EDM World Music Awards in the hood. I brought it to Inglewood. It took me 3 months to convince these people to take it from McCormick Place and spend the money up north to the castle of Excaliburs and say, hey, you know, if you're interested in the urban grind and what these guys are doing and what they're putting down, and you're saying, hey, you want to help them, I said, then help them afford it. So we got it down from $369, and I worked with them until we got it down to $50. So I want to keep that in the community to help out. We gave them a facility for free just to make sure that that happens. So I bit a big bullet on that, but I love my people and I love you guys. And I just want to thank you. If you have any questions for me as far as entertainment, the union, I'm here for you. Also, just to piggyback on what they were saying about the job, the Allied Laborers Union also has a website. It's 101, and it has a whole section on jobs and training. It's out there. We just have to take advantage of it. We have to read. You know, knowledge is power. Just go to the site, look at it. Everything is there for you. I run into so many people to say, hey, you know, I don't feel like it. It's too much to read, blah, blah, blah. Really? Come on, we can do better than that.
I'm going to say bring those babies to the firehouse for one. Number two, go to this website, www.cpfta.com. That's that program that will give your sophomore a college education for free. It's through the police collaboration with police and fire. This is important. We talk about the nucleus is our youth. This will give them something to make them want to do better. So for your sophomore to stagnate and got that idle devil's mind, take them there to that program. Because we either networking or we not working. Let's do this.
What's the website?
www.cpfta.com, and it'll give you the whole layout of the program. It's a wonderful program. And
high school
sophomores, you sign up as a sophomore. If you're a junior, you're too late. If you're a senior, you're definitely too late. So you got to sign up as a sophomore. And let me tell you, when we first started this program, we were the majority. Like we said, I have nothing against our Hispanic brothers and sisters because they're people of color also. But them kids take advantage. We got to convince our kids to start taking advantage. I believe that being desegregated was the worst thing in the world for us.
I'm so glad that you invited me. And I hope that maybe
I'll have some more information for you if I'm invited back again. And please think about what I said about your children.
Yeah.
That's my pet peeve, is our sons. And leave that door open for them so they can come in and talk to you. Okay?
I too want to thank Dr. Warren. He's one of my mentors, by the way. He's been telling me for about 10 years about my assets and my portfolio, and I appreciate that, because my family ain't going to fall from that stuff that's coming. But Forever Together Brothers, at forevertogetherbrothers.com is my email. Our website is forevertogetherbrothers.spoons.com. I'm restructuring it as well, but the children are running their own businesses now. Some of them in my organization. The most powerful one right now, to be honest, has been my 11-year-old daughter. My 11-year-old daughter reads at like a postgraduate college right now, so I have to give her things. She's running her own business. She does a presentation every Wednesday at 6:22 with her own conference call, and she talks about the sales and marketing of her product and why she's a young entrepreneur at 11. So we have to give them the tools that they have for this accelerated mind that our children have. And most people in here don't even know that there's an indigo child, a crystal child, and a star seed. You have to know what your child is. So do the research on that.
That's a blessing. I want to thank Dr. Warren, who happens to be my brother, for inviting me. But I just want you to really put the word out about people with disability. There's no shame in having a disability. And also for those that are in high school, if they have a disability, and once they become seniors, then they become adults, and then we will help them train to go further in their career. And then you could also look up DRS under DHS with the state of Illinois. Go to the state of Illinois and just stroll down to state agency and look up Department of Human Services, and then you would find every agency that comes under that. DHS is a super agency, and we're just one of the agencies that's under there, and we're 100% federally funded. I know Obamacare is under there too, but for people with disabilities, just look that up and give that word out, because we're the best kept secret. I'd be in the grocery store and I see people in wheelchairs and I think you got a disability, you buy bullets. Well, yeah, how you know? And they never heard of us. So pass the word. Thank you so much. Be blessed.
I'm going to say thank you, Dr. Warren, for inviting me. And I want to bring kind of one big thing that we talked about that we want to make sure we remember. Every transaction that you make is a triangular transaction. You buy money, you take your money and go to a merchant, and that merchant then takes that money. And if he does not live in your community, he takes that money with him when he leaves. So if you are this person and you buy from this person, and he's gonna buy from somebody else because he's gotta get supplies and employees and product and all of that, if it's not somebody in your community, it leaves your community. So when you see the blankness in your community, it's because that person, that business owner, is not buying from somebody in your community. Sure. He's not employing people from your community. So if you think about it, you've got to start the businesses, you've got to employ the people, and you've got to make sure that the money stays home. So if you want to understand that, it's about brain power.
You say your name and your business, and that's like the lady, and everybody come there and everybody in this part of the
okay. My name is Sakura Jackson. You can find more about me at SakuraJackson.com, and I'm the business doctor.
I'm Rose Parker with the state of Illinois under the agency DRS, and you can reach me personally by emailing me at rose.parker@illinois.gov. I am the employment resource specialist, and I work the city of Chicago as well as the South Suburbs, all the way down to Kankakee, Illinois.
Yes. Rose.parker@illinois.gov.
Sadat Muhammad, the founder and CEO of Forever Together Brothers, but I actually work for my wife. at Autonomous Enterprises. That's where you can contact me. Autonomous Enterprises, we develop business services as well as train children for businesses right now, grammar school and high school. And we also look to give services to our seniors because of some things that they're doing by allowing us to connect, stay connected with them. So I take you to senior residences and allow them to line up with people who have been in business or have developed businesses that are retired so that they can get a real good idea on the things that we need to develop that they have to experience by seeing themselves. They don't see themselves in school. We're whitewashed from history. They don't even, most of you in here don't even know our global civilization contributions, actually. You know, so Autonomous Enterprises, ForeverTogetherBrothers.com, and any information that you need about how I actually will come in any environment, I don't care where it's at, Project, Henry Horner, Cabrini Green, wherever, you can give me to come. I'll be glad to come, and I'll bring some of my young brothers with me that assist me as well in developing the type of things that we need to resolve in our community by knowing the causes and eliminating them, not just making an effort for a solution, but the causes.
Audrey Wright, CEO of Gordis Foundation, and C.H. Millery. Our website is www.gf28.org. We're 6430 South Ashland.
Jeffrey Porter, Chicago Fire Department, also Executive Director of Gordis Foundation. I can be contacted at way2.com. Also, if you want to contact me, you can call me personally at 773-434-2930.
Okay, my name is Derek Jones, Partners Group One Entertainment Records, Inc. My email is pmg1recordsinc@gmail.com. I'm also with the Allied Laborers Union. You can see that on the website. Just type it in just that way. Allied Workers Labor Union. Let's give our panelists a hand.
Yes.
Let's give them a big hand. Well,
we know it's getting late, but we want to ask our panelists, they're going to be leaving there, they're meeting to greet each other and going, but don't leave the room because we're on a time constraint. But our next speaker is Martin O'Shea. And you don't want to miss this, especially how they came across with issues that's dealing with what he's dealing with from a technology point of view. You know, so please, we know you're going to meet and greet them, but we want to have a 5 minutes to 7 minutes.
Come on, come here. Huh? I help young men to walk through the door and got their pants up under their butts. No, you don't walk in here like that, honey. I will get me a piece of material and tie that those pants around your waist until you leave here. You cannot come in my building. Your man came in and do some cleaning from the welfare. The welfare bill, they put you to work for those food stamps.
Yeah.
And he got nappy hair all over his head. And I got a guess. Cook County Correctional Center is sitting there. He come in looking like a boogie man. I pulled his coattail right there. That's the way I am. You see, nobody gives me money, so you can't pull strings on me.
Okay.
When they give you money, politicians